help me find the way. Bring me back to you. You're all I want. You're all I've ever needed. Draw me close to you.
Our world and our community are in need of Christ followers who are willing to live out their faith. They're in need of Christians who are willing to see a need and do something about it. Hope Encounter is a local outreach that your church is doing to meet the basic needs of so many in our local community. We'll be meeting up at Whitney Park to give out thousands of pounds of groceries. We want to give out a hot meal, meet health services, provide some free haircuts, and connect and grow with our community. That's where we need you. We're partnering with Convoy of Hope and Free International to supply so many basic needs, but we need your help. We need greeters. We need people to hand out meals. We need pickup trucks to move things to the park. We need hundreds of volunteers. So will you join us? Will you put your faith in action by joining us for Hope Encounter? You can register to be a volunteer by scanning the QR code on the bottom of the screen that you're watching or on the back of the chair in front of you. While you're there, you'll also find message notes to follow along with this week's message. Today, we're going to continue with our message series, James. So you can fill in the blank and you can follow along with today's message points. You can also see Bible verses that help support and encourage us in God's Word. Then you can email all these to yourself with life group questions where you can participate in this week's small group in whatever life group you're a part of. On the QR code, you can also find a link to give safe and securely on our website. Your generosity enables us to be able to equip and be generous with other organizations like Free International or Convoy of Hope or so many in our world and in our local community today. So thank you, church, for your generosity. If it's your first time here today, we would love to connect with you. We would love to get to know you. You can scan that QR code and let us know it's your first time so we can grow and support you and your family today. Welcome to church. Right now, we're going to connect with God. We're going to grow together. So let's dive in. Let's see what God has in store for us today.
Hey, church, I'm so excited to preach the word to you today because I know God has a message just for you. If you got your Bible, I hope you do, whether it's got pages or a screen, it is time to get in the Word. We are in the book of James, chapter 4. Go ahead and turn to James, chapter 4. While you're turning there, let me ask you this. You got friends? How many friends you got? You got some good friends? You got some not so good friends? You like your friends? Maybe don't like your friends? How are your friendships doing? I think maybe we're all lacking some friends. What about enemies? You got enemies? Ooh, I think we all might have some enemies. I know for a fact we all have one enemy. We might be talking about that in just a little bit. What about frenemies? Anybody got any frenemies? You know what a frenemy is, right? It's someone who pretends to be your friend face-to-face, only holding on to disdain under the surface and might talk about you behind your back, might gossip about you, might be like undermining you. Now listen, in life, you're going to have friends. Sometimes it'll be friends you expect, friends you're looking for. Sometimes it'll be friends you don't expect. Sometimes it's friends from the most unlikely places. Last weekend, my wife and I, Pastor Becca, we had an incredible opportunity to go and celebrate some friends. Back in 2010, and this is a long time ago, right? Like some of you listening in might not have been even born yet, or maybe just barely born. So back in 2010, I was the fill-in Bible teacher and assistant principal at GV Christian School for 1 year, just for a short term, just to help fill the gap while we were looking for somebody to fill it permanently. And in that 1 year, there were some students that I had an opportunity to interact with, engage with, connect with. And one of those students was a young man named Devin. For whatever reason, I look back and I don't think I did anything out of the ordinary. I think I was literally just there, just loving Jesus and loving on this kid and honestly busting him a little bit when he was being a punk. In that year, for whatever reason, something he saw in me, something God did, right, not me, affected him and impacted him. He and his wife, this last weekend, that's where we were in Georgia celebrating, him and his wife were installed as the lead pastors at their church in Augusta. And he wanted us to be there so badly because he, in his own words, said, I would not be in ministry today if it wasn't for the year that I spent with you at GV Christian. It was just such a blessing, honestly, and an encouragement and a reminder that you never know what impact you're having on someone's life by just reflecting Jesus and being who he called you to be. Sometimes your life is the best witness, not your words, not the things you say, simply life. And it impacts those around you. We're continuing through this series. Man, I've been so excited in this series on the book of James, just practical wisdom all the way through. Last week, Pastor Gary finished James chapter 3 in a message on relationships where he drew out some powerful principles and some practical wisdom for our relationships. So I want you to make sure you get online. If you missed that, to gvchristian.com or our GV Christian Center YouTube page, because there was some powerful stuff in there. God was all over this place. We're going to be picking up in James. In fact, I had to turn to James chapter 4. I want you to just go one verse before. We're going to start in James chapter 3, verse 18, and continue through James chapter 4. Just a reminder, the Bible was not written with chapters and verses. Most of these are letters or books of history, books of just telling what's happening, and they were not written where someone wrote 3 and then a tiny 1. That was added later so that people could have an easier time finding their place and following along as they were talking about the word together. So I want to make sure you understand that as we flow from one idea to the next. So James chapter 3, verse 18 says, "Peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness." There's so much in the Bible about peacemakers. I love what Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 5. Go check that out if you have time this week. But he continues in James chapter 4. He just rolls right into what causes fights and quarrels among you. So he's talking about peacemakers who sow in peace and reap a harvest of righteousness. And then he asks the question, what causes these fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from the desires that battle within you? Ooh. We talked about James being practical, right? James is hard-hitting. James pulls no punches. James is just letting it out there. Verse 2. He says, "You desire, but you don't have, so you kill. You covet, but you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. And when you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. You adulterous people," he says, "don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity with God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God." I want to read that verse again because we're really going to be focusing a lot this week on this idea. "Don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity with God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think Scripture says without reason that he jealously longs for the Spirit he has caused to dwell in us?" I love where he goes from here. "But he gives more grace." What a powerful statement. That's why Scripture says God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. "So submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve and mourn and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. Brothers and sisters, do not slander one another. Anyone who speaks against a brother or sister judges them, speaks against the law and judges it. When you judge the law, you are not keeping it, but sitting in judgment on it. There is only one lawgiver and judge, the one who is able to save and destroy. But you, who are you to judge your neighbor?" Remember, we just read that verse a couple weeks ago when we were in that message, judgment and mercy and the royal law, talking about judgment and finding mercy in God. Now, as I was studying this week, I was reading through this passage, James chapter 4, verse 1 through 12. And man, as I was reading, I was like, man, this just feels so familiar. Not familiar like I've read this before, but familiar like I feel like I was literally just in this. So I went back and started looking through some of my study notes and some of my messages, and I realized I literally just utilized this passage a few months ago when we were in that series, The Power of Grace. What an awesome series. Go check that out. When I preached the message titled, The Power of Grace is Sufficient, where we focused on that verse in verse 6 and talked about how we can receive God's all-sufficient grace. In verse 6, it says, He gives grace generously. For God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Now this week, we're going to be continuing through this deep study into the entire book of James, the practical wisdom contained in this book written by the brother of Jesus. I want to focus on the fights and quarrels Paul's writing about. How we can be peacemakers who, like James wrote in chapter 3, verse 18, sow in peace and reap a harvest of righteousness. What's so amazing to me about the Word of God is there's so many levels of depth and so many facets from which you can draw His wisdom and draw His goodness and draw His understanding and just find so much that you can apply to your life as you just dig into His Word. Honestly, we could probably preach this very passage 15 different ways and find 15 different messages from which we can apply different parts of God's word to our lives. This week, though, the message is titled, You've Got a Friend in Me. Any Toy Story fans out there? You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. When the road looks rough ahead and you're miles and miles from your nice warm bed. Just remember what your old pal said, yo, you've got a friend in me. Oh, come on now. You got a friend in me. Can we pray together as we get into the word this week? Jesus, we lay this down before you. We ask that you would open the word to our hearts, to our minds, to begin to apply what you have just for us today together. We need you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. You ever made a bad judgment call on a person? Stepped into a friendship or a relationship that you regretted? A relationship where maybe eventually that person betrayed you, hurt you, stabbed you in the back? You ever been the person who was the betrayer? The one who hurt someone else in a relationship, stabbed someone else in the back? So often, seems like one of the areas we find ourselves struggling the most and severely lacking in relationships is our ability to distinguish friend from foe. We have a hard time with that sometimes. We need to know who our enemies are, and we need to know who our friends are. This week, as we dig into this study in James chapter 4, we're going to practically learn just a little bit about how to do just that. And honestly, it starts with two simple questions. First, who's your friend? Who is your friend? You got to know your friends. And I'm just going to be 100% honest with you right here. You really only have one true friend. You know, everybody in your life, every human being that's part of your life, every relationship in this world, whether it be a spouse, a boyfriend or girlfriend, a father, a mother, a grandfather, a grandmother, a child, an aunt, an uncle, a cousin. It doesn't matter what the relationship is. They are human and they will fail you at some point. They will. They'll hurt you or you'll hurt them. There will be some kind of falling out that happens, something where someone is harmed and either the relationship will be severed or you will have to work towards reconciliation. You really only have one true friend in this world, one true friend in this life who will never leave you, never forsake you, never betray you. He's never going to give you up, never going to let you down, never going to run around or desert you. You know who it is? It's the God of the universe. The God of the universe wants to be your friend. Now listen, this is a concept I really want to spend some time on this week as we're digging into the word, because this should blow your mind. The God of the universe, who spoke the world and everything around it into being with a spoken word, who created you and set you in this world, in this time, in this place, for a very specific reason and purpose for you. Because only you can accomplish what you were made to do at this time in history. The God of the universe, who holds all things together, holds the universe in the palm of his hand, causes it all to spin and move, knows your name, knows the number of hairs on your head, knows you better than you know yourself. He wants to be your friend. This concept of friendship with God, it goes all the way through the Word of God. James chapter 2, verse 23. We read this just a couple weeks ago. It says this: "So it happened, just as scriptures say, Abraham believed God, and God counted him as righteous because of his faith. He was even called a friend of God." Abraham was called a friend of God. In Exodus chapter 33, we see a similar understanding. Inside the tent of meeting, the Lord would speak to Moses face to face as one speaks to a friend. It's mind-blowing to think that friendship with the God of the universe is freely available to anyone who wants it. What could possibly be greater than having God as a friend? How is such a friendship even possible? I love what Jesus said in John chapter 15, beginning of verse 13. He said, "There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends," he says, "if you do what I command. I no longer call you slaves, because a master doesn't confide in his slaves. Now you're my friends, since I've told you everything the Father told me." All right. So two simple questions. The first is, who's your friend? The next is, who is your enemy? You got to know your enemy. And really it boils down to this. You have really two main enemies in this world. First is the enemy within. That's the enemy on the inside. I love what James wrote. We just read this a couple minutes ago. I got to bring this back to you so that we can really just wrap our brains around it. What causes fights and quarrels around you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? Desires that battle within you. Let's think about that for a minute, right? Desires that battle within you. Lust, anxiety, depression, fear, anger, hatred, brokenness, greed, all these things. These are desires that battle within us, that want to manifest through us. It's the enemy trying to come. It's the enemy within trying to come out. All these desires that are at war within us. In verse 4, he says, "You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity with God?" In other words, if you choose to be a friend of the world and everything that the world contains, you choose to be an enemy of God. He says, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. The battle within, the enemy within. I love how Paul really just so eloquently drew this out in Romans chapter 7, beginning of verse 15. He says, "I don't really understand myself. I want to do what's right, but I don't do it. Instead, I do what I hate. But if I know what I'm doing is wrong, this shows that I agree that the law, the word of God, it's good. So I'm not the one doing the wrong. It's the sin living in me that does it. And I know that nothing good lives in me, that is in my sinful nature. I want to do what's right, but I can't. I want to do what's good, but I don't. I don't want to do what's wrong, but I do it anyway." Anybody relating to this? Come on. "But if I do what I don't want to do, I'm not really the one doing wrong. It's the sin living in me that does it. I've discovered this principle of life that when I want to do what's right, I inevitably do what's wrong. I love God's law with all my heart, But there's another power within me that is at war with my mind. This power makes me a slave to the sin that is still within me. Oh, what a miserable person I am, he says. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? Thank God. The answer is Jesus Christ our Lord. So you see how it is. And in my mind, I really want to obey God's law. But because of my sinful nature, I'm a slave to sin. I'm sure we've all heard that old adage, you're your own worst enemy, right? I would say that you are definitely one of your worst enemies, but I would not agree with that. You are not your own worst enemy. Because the second enemy that we need to be aware of is the enemy without. James chapter 4, verse 7, James just very clearly says, resist the devil and he will flee. You have to resist it. See, there is a darker force at work around you. There is a malevolent evil in this world that is out to destroy you. It hates you because you belong to God, because you choose to align yourself with God. It can't harm God, so it wants to harm you, because it's only in harming you that it can do any kind of damage to God. Now, last year, in October, we were in a series called I Need a Miracle. And in that series, we had a message called Jesus, My Deliverer, where we learned about the devil, the Satan, the words there. They're not names. This is not his name. His name is Lucifer, the morning star. He was an angel of light. He was beautiful. These are not his names, but devil is simply the Greek word for the adversary. Satan is simply the Hebrew word for the accuser. And that's what he is, your adversary and your accuser. Revelation 12, verse 10 says, the accuser of our brothers and sisters has been thrown down to the earth, the one who accuses them before God day and night. In Job chapter 1, we see a picture of this as it says in verse 6, one day the angels came to present themselves before the Lord, and the Satan also came with them. The Lord said to the Satan, the accuser, where have you come from? The accuser, Satan, answered the Lord, from roaming throughout the earth, going back and forth on it. So once you've begun to distinguish friend from foe and learn to clearly determine who is your greatest friend and who is your true enemy, what do you do from here? Well, I want to wrap this up with just three practical things that I think are honestly some of the most important things we can do as believers. Right here in this passage, right here throughout the Word of God. The first is this, you got to fight it out with your true enemy. James wrote, resist, right? In fact, he said in 4 verse 7, submit yourselves then to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Something powerful about that concept of resisting the devil, because here's the thing, he will do anything he can to tempt you, to harm you, to come at you in any way possible. He's going to look for any chink in your armor. He's going to look for any weakness. He's going to look for anywhere that he can get a foothold in your life. He's going to throw flaming arrows at you. Those flaming arrows being thoughts, being temptations, being things that you would never even imagine. You ever had a moment when you think to yourself, where did that thought even come from? What in the world? What is that? Whether it be like a dark thought, a temptation, could be something where you're taking yourself from sadness into depression, into anxiety. Could be something where maybe you're feeling angry and now that anger is turning into hatred and you just want to move in destruction. It could be something where you are feeling like love and desire and loneliness and it turns into lust. This is what the enemy does. He takes what God created, the emotions God made for you, And he tries to nudge them with his flaming arrows, nudge them with his fiery darts, nudge them with his attacks to see, can I push you into depression? Can I push you into anxiety? Can I push you into self-destruction? Can I push you into lust? Can I push you into pornography? Can I push you into hatred and destruction? How far can I push you? That's why the Bible says, resist the devil and he must flee. We resist him in prayer. We resist him in the word. We resist him in our relationship with others. We resist him in worship. We're going to talk more in just a few minutes about some of these things. I love what Paul writes in Corinthians. He says, I cast down all imaginations, those flaming arrows of the enemy, and I take captive every thought, making it obedient to Jesus Christ, my Lord. Resist the enemy. Fight it out with your enemy. Remind you what Ephesians chapter 6 says. Now, I know we go to Ephesians 6 a lot, right? I feel like, honestly, at least once a month in a message here at GV Christian, we bring up Ephesians 6, but I think it's because it's so important to be reminded what it says. Be strong in the Lord and his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God, so you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle, our fight, our battle is not against flesh and blood, but it's against the rulers, against the authorities, the powers of this dark world, the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you've done everything, to stand. So stand firm then. I love what Paul writes to Timothy in his letter to Timothy. He's encouraging this young pastor, this young man that he himself had poured into. He was mentoring him. He was leading him. And now Timothy is leading in his own church, and Timothy is pastoring his own church. And Paul says this, flee the evil desires of youth. So many evil desires, right? And so many of them crop up in youth. But he says, flee these evil desires and instead pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Wait, hold on. Remember what we started with in the beginning of James chapter 4? What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from evil desires that battle within you? Listen to what Paul writes to Timothy in verse 23. Don't have anything to do with foolish and stupid arguments, because you know they produce quarrels. Some of you online, some of you on your social media, you need to listen to this right now. Stop being a keyboard warrior. Get yourself out of those places. Just check out of social media, okay? Use it for fun things, for memes, to laugh, to share scriptures, to share encouragement. Stop trying to argue people into heaven on social media. Get out of there. I'm off my soapbox now. Verse 24. The Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but must be kind to everyone, able to teach, not resentful. Opponents must be gently instructed, the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading to a knowledge of the truth, and that they will come to their senses and escape from the trap of the devil who has taken them captive to do his will. All right, so you got to resist, you got to fight your true enemy. Next, you got to hang out with your truest friend. When you have a friend, you just want to hang out with them, don't you? You just want to like go to a movie or invite them over to play a game or have dinner, just go to coffee. You just want to hang out with them. When you have a friend, someone who fills you up, someone who encourages you, this is what we're called to with Jesus. How? Well, I think it's easy, but it also takes work. And it can only come from you. You gotta press into him. There's that story of the woman who pressed through the crowd just to touch the hem of his robe. This is what we need to do daily. We need to press into him. James chapter 4, James writes this in verse 8, draw near to God and he'll draw near to you. See, no matter how far you find yourself from him, and let's be honest, there are times in our lives that we find ourselves far from him. And it's not because he went away from us. It's because we went away from him. But no matter how far we find ourselves from him, if we take one step back, he crosses the vast expanse of eternity to be with us. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. But then it takes it a step further, okay? So yes, take that step, draw near to him. But now for you to really get close to him, to really press into him, cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Get rid of all the stuff that has been taking you away from him. Get rid of all the ideas, all the temptations, all the things, the screens that have been drawing you away from him. Be wretched, it says, mourn and weep. Because the choices you've made that have hurt the heart of God. Let your laughter be turned to mourning, your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. That means he will lift you up. Celebrate Recovery. It's a powerful ministry we host here every Tuesday night at GV Christian. And in Celebrate Recovery, there are principles that go along with steps. There are 8 principles and 12 steps. And the 7th principle of Celebrate Recovery that goes along with the 11th step says this. Principle 7, reserve daily time with God for self-examination, Bible reading, prayer, in order to know God and his will for my life and to gain the power to follow his will. And then the 11th step of Celebrate Recovery says, we sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God, praying only for knowledge of his will for us and the power to carry out that will. Celebrate Recovery, for those that don't know, it's for anybody. Because all of us struggle with hurts, with habits, and with hangups. And so whether it be an anger issue, whether it be an addiction, whether it be deep-seated hurt and pain from the past, these principles, these steps are made in such a way to help you find healing. And here, one of the most important is time with God, pressing into God, reading the Bible, praying, knowing God better through prayer, through contact with him, just seeking him. I love what Psalm 63 says. God, you are my God. Earnestly, I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you. In a dry and parched land where there is no water, I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. I will be fully satisfied as with the richest of foods. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you. On my bed, I will remember you. I will think of you throughout the watches of the night because you are my help. I sing in the shadow of your wings. I cling to you, and your right hand upholds me. You gotta draw near, draw in. Find that satisfaction that only comes in him, that connection. We got to taste and see. I love what Psalm 34, verse 8 says, taste and see that the Lord is good. Oh, the joys of those who take refuge in him. It's funny because this last week, one of our students at GV Christian School in the high school, his name's Ethan, he preached in chapel and he preached a message on this. And I'm telling you, I went to the altar. So many other students went to the altar because the idea is God's God's just there. He's waiting for you. And Ethan used the idea of an In-N-Out burger, how good an In-N-Out burger is. But if you're not willing to taste it, how are you going to ever see how good it is? You got to taste and see. You got to take time to go to him, encounter him, intentionally find yourself in his presence. And that only comes from pursuit of him. We got to seek and find. I love what Jeremiah 29 says in verse 12. In those days when you pray, I'll listen. God promises us. And he's talking to the people of Israel here when he's telling them, you're going to be in exile. You're going to go through hardship. You're going to be out and far away from me. But in those days when it seems like everything is hopeless and everything is lost, when you pray, he says, I'll listen. If you look for me wholeheartedly, he says, you will find me. I will be found by you, says the Lord. In Deuteronomy chapter 4, Deuteronomy is a contract between God and the people of Israel as they're getting ready to enter into the promised land. It's written in the same form that a king would write a contract to the people that he serves at the same time in history. And it says this, but if from there you seek the Lord your God, you will find him if you seek him with all your heart and all your soul. When you are in distress and all things have happened to you, then in later days, you will return to the Lord your God and obey him. You just got to hang out with your truest friend. And this can be anything. Taking time daily in the Word. Listen, we get so overwhelmed by this idea of being in the Word. I think people think, oh, I have to do the Bible in a year. Or I have to do this. Or I have. No, you don't. If you want to do the Bible in a year, do the Bible in a year. If you don't, don't. But just figure out a way to be in the Word every day. Maybe start with a psalm a day or a proverb a day. Maybe start with the book of John and just see the love story of Jesus and the people. Start in the gospel, start in Romans and see how all of this is kind of flushed out as now the disciples and the apostles are going out into the world. Read the book of Acts and see what happened after Jesus was risen from the grave and went and did his Superman thing in the sky. Just be in the Word and discover God, who he is and what he has for you. Because there's so much in here just for you. And it doesn't require you to be studying this hours a day. You can take 10 minutes a day and watch what happens as you just take that intentional time to be with him. Prayer. Listen, again, we get these weird ideas what prayer is, that it has to be this like formal thing where we're saying these and thous and it has to be like, whatever, or we get the wrong idea that it's like, you know, God is a vending machine, and if I drop my prayers in, put my quarters in, and pull the right lever, he's going to give me what I want, right? Like some kind of prosperity nonsense. No, listen. Prayer is simply a conversation with God. In the book of Thessalonians, Paul writes, pray without ceasing. In other words, prayer is a conversation that you can keep going. Imagine it this way. You got a person that you love in a Bluetooth earpiece, right? You got an earbud going. And you just keep that call all day long. That like no matter where you go, no matter what you do, they are right there in your ear. That like even as you're talking, even as you're working, no matter what you're doing, you are focused on the idea that they're listening to you and you're listening to them and you're just having this ongoing conversation in every moment throughout the day. This is what it is with God. It's just an ongoing conversation. I love what Paul writes in Philippians. Tell God what you need. Thank him for what he's done. And when you do, when you pray, his peace will guard your heart and mind through Christ Jesus. Worship. Man, worship is such a key and pivotal part of this. But we get, again, wrong ideas of worship. We think of worship as like a concert. Like there has to be a band and I have to be in an audience and they have to invoke me to worship. They have to draw me into worship. No. That's the wrong idea. I love what Francis Chan said. One day a random churchgoer came walking up to him and said, "You know, I really didn't like worship today." And Francis Chan replied, "That's okay. We weren't worshiping you." See, we get this idea that we got to focus on the stage and we got to appreciate what's happening from the stage and the stage is the concert for me. No. Anyone who's on a stage is only there to lead you, but you are part of that band. And you are not the audience. And you are not there to enjoy or appreciate the worship that is taking place. You are there to participate in the worship that is taking place, whether it's your style or not, whether you like it or not, whether it's your favorite singer or not, whether it's drums or a piano or an organ or a guitar, it doesn't matter because you're part of the band and you're all performing for an audience of one. We are worshiping Him together. You got to hang out with your friend. So you're not here to change the world. Did you know that? You might be like, "But Pastor Steve, I thought you said that like we have to change the world." Let me just be clear on this. You are not here to change the world. That is a selfish and prideful ideal and endeavor focused on building the wrong kingdom. You are here to encounter the God of the universe and be changed by Him. That is the reason you're here on earth. His kingdom come, His will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Your greatest goal and purpose in this life should simply be to know Him more each day. Last thing I want to leave you with as we wrap up. So we got to fight our real enemy. We got to hang out with our truest friend, then we gotta surround ourselves with His friends, man. Too often we surround ourselves with the wrong people. 1 Corinthians 15:33, Paul reminds us, don't be misled. Bad company corrupts good character. Who is the company you're surrounding yourself with? I want to leave you with John chapter 15. We just read this a few minutes ago, but I want to expand where we read just a little bit more. Jesus says in verse 12, "This is my commandment, love each other in the same way that I've loved you. There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. You're my friends," He says, "if you do what I command. I no longer call you slaves because a master doesn't confide in his slaves. Now you are my friends," He says, "since I've told you everything the Father told me. You didn't choose me. I chose you. I appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit so the Father will give you whatever you ask for using my name. This is my command, love one another." Hang out with your truest friend. Surround yourself with His friends. He said, "Love each other the same way that I've loved you. You are my friends if you do what I command. This is my command. Love each other." And isn't it cool that Jesus Himself says, "You got a friend in me. I chose you. You got a friend in me." And as the years go by, A friendship will never die. You're gonna see it's our destiny. 'Cause you've got a friend in me. Let's pray. Jesus, you see your people right where they are. Whether tuning in live, online, in traditions, those watching on YouTube, those listening in their cars, God, you see your people right where they are. And you see those moments that they have found themselves just entangled with fights and quarrels, the battles within them, the enemy within, the enemy without, all these things, the noise. But I ask Jesus that you would calm it all now and help them to learn to distinguish friend from foe, to see that their real enemy is out for their destruction, but that you are their truest friend. Right where you are, will you just say these words with me? Jesus, help me to stand against my enemy and to pursue you, my truest friend. Help me to press into you, to taste and see that you are good, to seek you and find you as I seek you with all my heart. Jesus, help me seek you. I just want to spend time with you. I just want to know you more. In Jesus' name, amen. Right where you are, will you just receive this blessing from the word of the Lord? May the Lord bless you and protect you, smile on you, and be gracious to you. The Lord show you his favor and give you his peace, that you may love one another the way he loved you. Though you were not before, now you're his friends. You didn't choose him, he chose you. Now go produce lasting fruit and follow his command. Love each other. Wherever you go, whatever you do. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. I love you. Go walk with your friend and see what he can do in you. Amen. We'll see you next week.